So with all these dodgy people, you know, how easy is it to get in contact with somebody that can make someone disappear?
Why, who do you want to disappear?
It's my ex-husband. He's married twice. So the first husband is the not very nice one.
Right.
He's still making my life a living now.
Just tied up, taped up, and kicked the fuck out of and left in Thetford Forest. You can get that arranged. Other things are very, very, very expensive. Like 10, 15 grand for escalator.
Reliable?
Mm-hmm. Need names, addresses.
I know where he lives.
Right, okay.
Can you phone?
My phone?
What? Yeah, well, I'm not going to write it down, am I?
Your opportunity to talk to me.
They have lifted prints. Are they going to be yours?
Every minute that's ticking away is evidence you're losing.
What's happened? I split up with this young lady that I've been with for about 10 months, 11 months. But over the last fortnight, she's been behaving very suspiciously and she's been quite aggressive. Last Monday, I was staying at hers and I went to work and she messaged me, she said she got a friend coming round, somebody that she told me about that she met at school and that she'd recently got in touch with again. Anyway, rightly or wrongly, I left my phone in her living room under the stairs, my voicemail recording, because I was so suspicious about her. Tuesday night, I got back to her house from work and I played back the recording. But she's asking this man to find somebody to make her first husband disappear.
Cambridgeshire Police are investigating a conspiracy to murder.
What are her exact words?
With the contacts that you've got, how easy would it be for you to make somebody disappear?
There's a job that's come in, a bloke by the name of Graham Wall is in a relationship with a girl by the name of Victoria Breeden. He's come in to say that he's been in a relationship with her on and off for the last 10 months. I think they split up a couple of times and got back together, and that she's had a bad past. We'll have to look for more details around that. But what he's saying is he became jealous of her behaviour. She was having some sort of conversations or relationship with someone who she said was an ex-school friend. And he says he's left his phone in the house because he was jealous of her, swapped SIM cards, and he's got some sort of recording of her asking another man who's in the address if he would be able to kill this ex-partner. If someone thinks they're being cheated on, I reckon it can make them act in ways they wouldn't normally act. They're jealous, they think something's going on with their partner and potentially other people, and they want to gather evidence of that to prove it or disprove it.
So where's that recording now?
He's got it on his phone, so we'll have to download that. It'd be quite interesting to see what's on that recording and listen to it and get some more information around it, because there's quite a few concerning features in that.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt. I'm just trying to get hold of the mobile phone download for this conspiracy to murder.
So what we're going to do, I think, is listen to this recording and see what it actually says and see whether we got any offences there. Obviously, we'll have to keep an open mind depending on what's on that. Have we got it downloaded?
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to do the listening, yeah?
So there's an app on here somewhere.
This one here?
Yeah.
And play it?
It's all the fens, it's very open, flat. Some people say they have webbed feet here and they're very insular, but they're not.
I think in the early days she did genuinely care for me. But I think she had an ulterior motive now, when I look back, right from the start.
So let's go back to the beginning. How did you meet her?
On a dating site. Well, when you get to 45, you see. I saw a picture, I could like the look of her. I sent her a message, she sent a message back. Well, when I met her, she was charming and she was full of life. I was just drawn to her, in all honesty. I just liked the way she looked. She looked quite warm. I wanted a soulmate and she said she wanted a soulmate. And I felt that we possibly had the potential to become soulmates. We met on the third day. So I drove over to her house. She said she lived in the sticks, in the middle of nowhere. And that's my cup of tea. I like to be out of the city. And straight away, we ate it off. And she grabbed my hand and she said, "You're not going anywhere until you give me a proper snog." Maybe I was in need of some company as well. Maybe that's why I dropped into things so quickly. I think we'd made love on the third night. I fell for her straight away. The fact that she had a child, it didn't worry me at all. We went for a walk and we were holding hands and I felt, I enjoyed the feeling. It was like we were all together. And I always used to think that was just rubbish. How could you fall in love on the first day? Soon learned in the relationship that I wasn't the person for her. You know, why cheat on me? Why not just tell me to go away? I was utterly disgusted. Because she's got me into such a situation, I'd recorded her. I think she was only with me really for her own selfish benefit.
So with all these dodgy people, you know, how easy is it to get in contact with somebody that can make someone disappear?
I don't know, it's not that hard, basically. I just need to know, like, name, date of birth, is it, picture.
Is it costly?
Can be costly, yeah. Depends what you want done. Just to get someone bundled in the boot of the car and kicked to death and left in Thetford Forest. I can get people to do that. Why, who do you want to disappear?
I told you that I'd have to tell you my past.
Right.
That's my ex-husband. He's married twice. So the first husband is a not very nice one.
Right. Once they've got an address, they'll flatten your car, destroy your car, and then when you come flying outside to realise that something's gone wrong in your car, they'll just put a brick across your head. Fuck off. That's it, done job. Simple as.
Told her my
name
from school.
Yeah.
Because it's just easier.
Yeah,
no, that's
absolutely.
Because
that
would just gonna make a 100 times
worse. I was like, oh well actually it was a dating site. Yeah. No, I won't mention that. What is his name?
Graham.
I couldn't believe she had been so deceiving. That she'd said things about me and slagged me off.
How big is he? Is he bigger than me?
No,
that's all right. He ain't gonna say shit then, is he? Right, mate, what do you say? Tell him I'm just pulling my pants up now.
Stop. That would not do me any favours. Let me just wet a towel, pretend it's soaked with cum or something.
Well, I'm running everything round in my head. She's in my head. She's got in my head. What, you think I'm mad? Think I'm loopy? But I found it very odd, because I soon learned, as the relationship went on, that she was speaking to this man frequently. Are they lovers? Do they still meet up? What's going on between them?
On the recording, Victoria Breedon is speaking to a male who we've identified through phone records and intelligence as Earl Gernon. She says he's an ex-friend, but it seems from our investigations she's met on Badoo, the dating website. So whether they're involved in a sexual relationship or not is something that we'd have to establish. He's got some previous convictions for violence-related offences. He's an ex-drug dealer. So he's somebody we need to track down and speak to. With a conspiracy to murder offence, somebody's asking somebody to do something for them. So the most dangerous person is the one who's going to do it. He's at liberty walking around, free. So we need to stop him.
Hello, mate.
Does Earl Gernon live here?
No, thank you.
Not anymore? If he is in here, you're in danger of being arrested as well for harbouring an offender, all right?
I'm looking for an Earl Gernon.
Got to go out the gate, yeah. Down the road.
To police, is anyone in?
Before I became a family man, I was one of the biggest drug dealers in the area. I used to set a kilo of coke with. I was earning like £4,000 or £5,000 a week cash profit. You know, I had the best motorbikes, best cars, best of everything.
It's not up here.
But it's not here. I mean, I had a good look through the letterbox. That's disappointing.
When I tackled her the next day and told her I'd recorded her, I said, I should be going to the police with this recording. And she said that she was wrong and that I had to discard it, and I said I'd discarded it. I lied to her and said I got rid of it, which I didn't. Am I wrong to do that? I don't know. I heard what I heard, but then on the other hand, I feel like I've betrayed her by reporting her.
Sir Quentin McBarnes, I'll speak in. What's she come into the inquiry office for? Taking the phone. We can't really let her go now, we've got hold of her. If she's got a phone, I want that seized, and then she can come here and we can ask her the questions that we need to. Well, she's handed herself in at the inquiry office in relation to her Ely, yeah, in relation to the other incident. She's reported that Graham Wall has taken her phone. It's not her phone, it's his phone, and it's her way of trying to, we believe, get it back. To try and destroy the evidence.
I'm just going to ask you just to move that chair that way just slightly. Sorry, that's it. What have you done to your back?
I had a procedure on it. I'm still in recovery.
You're still in recovery? OK, all right. Before we go any further, there's something I need to say to you. OK, all right. Time is 3:15. On the 9th of October, okay? At this moment in time, I'm placing you under arrest.
I'm sorry?
I'm placing you under arrest for the offence of conspiracy to commit murder. You do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you do not mention when questioned something you later rely on in court. Anything you do say may be given in evidence. Your arrest is necessary so that we can complete a prompt and effective investigation. So at this moment in time, you're now in custody. All right.
I need to go pick up my son.
We will sort out any arrangements you've got for childcare. Where's your nearest family? Where's the nearest person that can take care of your son?
My mum, sorry. I don't know her details because I haven't got my phone, because my ex took my nothing.
Okay, all right.
He's got my keys, he's got my phone, he's got everything.
Right, okay. Well, as I say, we have to go through the process that we're going through, all right?
Sorry.
That's okay. Do you have any phone numbers? Do you, can you remember any phone numbers or anything like that?
He took everything.
Did he?
Yeah.
Okay. Just
don't understand why I'm here.
Okay.
I just wanted to get myself
through. I know.
Is she all right? How did she take being arrested? Yes, they're on the way now. It'll be Craig and Louisa. We'll come up and collect her and bring her back to Parkside.
I'm supposed to keep my lip warmer because my scarf's in the car.
Is it? What was the procedure that you had done on your back?
Yeah, I had to do with the disc on my nerves.
Right.
Can I stand up, please?
Yeah, if you need to, that's fine.
Yeah, no, we'll get that sorted. Tell her that will be done. Obviously, she needs some medication. She'll get assessed when she gets here. So obviously, she'll have a fitness to be detained when she gets here. And if she needs any assistance or help or medication, I'm sure the FME can sort that out.
How are you doing, Victoria? Is the pain eased at all? Yeah? No? Okay, I'm just going to step over you. I'm sorry about that.
I'm a paramedic. Okay. Okay, it's probably something
here. She's suffering from back pain.
We've got to get past the hurdle of her being assessed in custody and fit to be detained, haven't we?
A paramedic assesses Victoria Breeden, and she is deemed fit to be detained.
Brilliant, sorted. Because otherwise we're going to be in a position where she's up hospital and we're babysitting her, aren't we? Yeah, nice one. Cheers, mate. Spot on. Cheers. Bye.
With one suspect in custody, the other hands himself in.
What's your surname, please?
Going on G-E-R-N-I-N.
And your first name?
Earl. E-A-R-L.
So your circumstances are Earlier's been implicated in making arrangements with a Victoria to murder one of her ex-husbands.
Right, okay.
I've only ever met Victoria twice in my life.
She's some random bird who stalks me off the internet.
I can't. We're not allowed to discuss anything with you on the phone.
Yeah, as I can say, I can't really tell you much, mate. I've met her twice. We've been about three days.
So, what have you got there for property?
Is it just basically, just hat and a coat. That's it.
Do you need keys or anything to get into wherever you're living?
No, I've got no keys. Literally, I live on a farm in the middle of nowhere. I've got about half a mile, long mile driveway, and you're some sort of complete natter if you want to come down my driveway and open my door at 2 o'clock in the morning. Basically, we've got 16 stone Rottweiler, a Staffordshire Bull Terrier, and my dad's dog that runs around sometimes when he's there.
I'm just gonna have a look
around
your
top, mate. Yeah, you're right, mate. No worries. Whichever way you want me to go, just be nice. Because that's basically what I do. I live in scrapyards, and I've got a box of gay little gloves as well. We call them bitch mittens. The boys all take the piss because I wear bitch mittens. Sorry, he's gone up high there. He likes his day job.
So your joggers are smelling quite strong with cannabis. You got any cannabis?
No. I'm a chav, so I do have a habit of doing that, of putting my hand on the car. Yeah, but it's not because I'm trying to conceal something.
If you get changed, I'm getting changed.
I ain't shy, but I've still got nothing to be shy of, mate. I'm changing trousers. Left leg, right leg, body will follow.
If you want to go with my colleague?
No worries.
With both suspects held in custody, police are ready to take a first account.
I want to talk through just some of the people who may have been involved in the conversation that we've heard. We arrested Earl Gurnon. We are quite happy it's him, yeah, that we've arrested, and he was the one you were speaking to.
OK, Earl. Can you explain what your relationship with Victoria is?
No.
Is that no because you don't know?
No, just don't know.
OK.
Earl, I'm just reminding you, you don't have to answer these questions.
Mm-hmm. I'm not answering any questions, I'm just sitting there
I'm going to play you a recording now, OK?
of a conversation that you had with Earl at your home address.
So with all these dodgy people, you know, how easy is it to get in contact with somebody that can make someone disappear?
I don't know, it's not that hard. Basically, I just need to know, like, name, date of birth, picture.
Is it costly?
Rough whereabouts. Can be costly, yeah. Depends what you want done.
It was a joke, it wasn't serious. I didn't want him to go and do anything.
I don't want to murder anybody, I don't want to do anything like that. And...
Oh, you don't have to answer any questions.
Yeah, I know. Okay. I'm just saying statement what's written there, really, that I don't want to murder anyone, I don't really wish to hurt anyone.
Was that a joke, then, that you were saying in that?
No, what's an actual fucking joke, sitting there looking at you, mate, to be fair, that's what's joking.
He said that he'd be able to find out where he lived for me.
But that's not the content of that conversation initially, is it? He's talking about putting someone in a boot, kicking fuck out of them, and taking them to a forest. That's not finding out where somebody lives, is it? And then you're asking, reliable, and how much would that cost?
It was just a conversation. It wasn't meant to mean anything.
Is there any explanation you want to give me to this at all? Still awake?
You obviously harbour quite a grudge against this individual, don't you? Why do you have conversations about disappearing him then?
It didn't mean anything.
Well, you could have stopped at any point.
It wasn't a serious conversation.
The law says you commit a conspiracy the minute you agree on a course of action, but it's proving that agreement, when it took place, how it took place, who instigated it. They can argue that they never intended to bring it about. It was just a conversation, it was a joke, it was a laugh between friends. Now, I've listened to it numerous times. It's very hard to actually say that a full agreement was made to carry that offence out. And you'd have to gather further evidence in furtherance of what might be a conspiracy.
Is there anything you wanted to add then before we end this interview?
I don't have anything.
No? Okay. In that case, Earl, I've got no more questions for you.
Never accused of anything like this at all before, do you know what I mean? This is like a serious thing, isn't it? What the fuck's going on? Murder? I don't want to murder nobody. What are you on about? You've been speaking to someone's chatting shit, like. All I want to do is just go home, because I ain't done nothing wrong. Because I'm not a bad person.
We've done some investigations into Victoria's past, and the main person who we believe she's referring to is her first husband, Rob Parks. They divorced in 2009. It seems that she has a child with Rob Parks. It looks like the divorce was not amicable. It was quite disputed.
My first ex-husband is incredibly clever. He will whittle out of anything that you try to do legally.
Right.
Straight-laced, will join all the local organisations, PTAs, make himself look squeaky clean, and he's not. He's still making my life a living now.
Yeah.
Please don't underestimate him.
It is very important to understand the relationship between the victim and the offender. I always believe there's a catalyst to it. There's always something that has happened, especially in domestic-related matters. And sometimes the victim holds the key to tell us why that is. I sent a incident for a welfare check in relation to an investigation which is ongoing here in Cambridge. There's been some threats around his safety, and we just want to make sure he's alive and well, really, and it's reasonably urgent that we do that. Yeah, his name is Rob Parks.
Essentially, on Tuesday night, we had someone attend the police station with a recording. It's basically stating there's a recording of Victoria and another person conspiring to murder someone.
Right.
The content of that recording is directed towards yourself.
The past history that I've got with her, I would never have thought that she would have gone this far.
So she never says, this is what I want, how much would it cost, when can you do it sort of thing. I get the feeling that they are sort of talking about it, but when it comes to a point where they may make a formal agreement and enter that conspiracy, she sort of backs away and it's never formalised.
Victoria Breeden and Earl Gurnon are in custody at Parkside Police Station. Detectives are investigating the part each is alleged to have played in a conspiracy to murder plot.
But the only thing from the recording that bothers me is she breaks away for a little bit, goes in search of an address, and then she brings back what seems to be a piece of paper with an address on and gives it to him. So I think she's exchanged an address where she thinks her ex-partner's living with him.
We've got officers now going to Rob Park's address to check on him.
The only way that I can describe how serious it is that Victoria has been arrested for conspiracy to murder and she's still in custody. And the second person that was also on that recording has been arrested as well. So DS Barnshaw has contacted me to get a statement to police.
Yeah, absolutely. Do I believe it's possible? Yeah. That's why we've moved so many times, in order to make sure that they don't find us.
When did you first meet Victoria?
We met at university in 1999. I was 19. She was quite bubbly. I mean, she was quite enthusiastic. She very much depended on me and others to solve her problems for her. And that is a thing that has lasted for the time that I've known her.
Our child was born in 2006.
A year or so later, 2007, I was starting to realise that this was not just toxic, but it was bleeding out into every other relationship. I hadn't got any friends. I hadn't been in touch with my family. I was effectively being removed from every single part of my life.
Victoria is incredibly good at providing that veneer. But it's only through time you start to understand that is not necessarily what it appears to be. Victoria and I met at the Amateur Dramatics Society, and she would help out behind the scenes. She was only my second real girlfriend back at 19, and I didn't have an understanding about what it was to be a grown-up, let alone a partner. And I'm not sure that a partner is really what she was looking for. From the start, there was always an aspect of control. The person that I knew, the person that I first met, is not the same person as now. But there are similarities. And I tried to step back many times, but no matter how many times I tried to say, we need to find some space. There was always a call, there was always a message. There's always a reason why she turned up at the door. Once we got married, it took me 6 years and a daughter to finally leave and make the best life that I possibly could. And I think she's angry because when we met, our whole life was ahead. And when I left, perhaps it represented that life that she couldn't have. It created a chain of reactions that resulted in where we are now. I was awarded custody of my daughter and she came to live with me.
As a reaction to the allegation started, she had me cautioned for stalking, various different accusations from anything from paedophilia to mental abuse, physical abuse towards her and me towards other children that I didn't know.
He cheats on me with my best friend and then married her. It's not the worst thing he's done, but he's had a reputation in Bletchley for hanging around areas he shouldn't really be hanging around, ripping people off and being around underage girls.
Right.
After taking a statement from the victim, police are ready to question their suspect.
Can you tell me about Rob Parks and your relationship with him?
He was
Mike's husband.
Right. And when was the last time you saw him?
7 years ago.
Are you in any contact with him at present? Do you know how to contact him? Do you know where he's actually living or who he's living with? What's the situation? Do you have a daughter with Rob? Yes? What's the situation around your daughter? If I don't want to upset you, I'm just trying to understand what the situation is.
I tried to take her with me. He took me to court and he won't.
It's all right, no. I know I've got a child of my own and I can understand how I would feel if I hadn't seen my child for 7 years. Have you taken any steps then, legally or in any other matter, to try and get access to your daughter?
I tried, but he threatened me.
How did he threaten you?
He said he'd make my life hell.
Why did you say he's a paedophile?
Because I found photos on his phone and he tried to deny them.
What sort of photos?
Of young girls.
And how long ago was that?
Near the end of our relationship.
Okay. But that presents me with a little bit of a conundrum because you're happy, or are. You've had a daughter with this man, who you're calling a paedophile, yet you are allowing your daughter to live with him.
I don't have any choice for her to live.
So you don't believe your daughter's in any danger from a man you call a paedophile?
I don't have any choice. That's why I also need to contact them for me.
Is that your motive for wanting Rob to disappear?
No. I don't want Rob to disappear because he would lose her dad.
OK, fair enough. I don't want to distress you on that. I don't want to ask you anything further.
Unless there's anything you want to add, Victoria.
I'm concluding the interview. She denied it all in the interview. She didn't mean it. She's never wanted to harm ex-husband, Rob. He's the father of her kids and she wouldn't want her kids to be damaged, even though she's saying that Rob's a paedophile. There's no records of him having a criminal record, being in trouble with the police, or being a paedophile in any way.
There's no substance to those allegations. She's not accusing Rob of criminal damage or theft. She's accusing him of being a paedophile, and that's an emotive crime, and that's going to ignite a response in most people. Once you've played with someone's basic human emotion, where do you stop? There's no line. You're just going to keep going until you get what you want.
She's obsessed with Rob. If I bring him up, she becomes quite enraged and tells me to shut up and not talk about it. But then when she wants to bring it up, she'll talk about him with contempt. She hates the man. She's very angry inside. She's very bitter. I don't think she thinks very much about herself. I said part of me wants to retract all the statements that I've made, and they are the truth, and try and help her myself. I want to talk to her. I said to her once, I said, you know, why don't we go and find somebody for you to talk to? About what? I said, about your mental state. I said, because there's something not right. But she didn't agree to it, but she sort of admitted that she had gone a bit, so that she was a little bit not quite right. But she blamed that on what Rob had put her through. I think she just blames Rob for everything. We got into a discussion one evening, we were in each other's arms, and she started to cry. And I said, what's the matter? And she said, I'm happy, my child's not. And I said, well, I'm sure she's fine. I said, well, let's get to a solicitor, let's go back to court, let's see if we can do something about you seeing your daughter. And she got on about Rob then, saying that he'd said to her that if she tried to make any contact, that he would harm the child. And I said, in what way? And she said, in a sexual way. He's a paedophile. She said, you must know somebody. You must know somebody who can get rid of him. I said, I'm sorry. I was shocked. She said, you must know somebody that can finish him off, get rid of him.
And what did you think she meant by that?
Well, kill him. I said, you're wrong in the head. And we had quite a heated discussion about it. And then she said to me, well, if you can't do that, then you're no use to me. I think she's serious. I think she is capable of getting somebody to do it.
Victoria Breeden is being held at Parkside Police Station.
I think the main motivation around it comes back to her relationship with Rob Parks, who she was married to. It seems he has custody of their daughter and has parental responsibility for her. And it would seem that she doesn't have access to her. And that is the issue that's causing the tension for her. Because it seems from the statement from Graham Wall, who is our informant for this job, that she's under the impression that if Parks disappeared, she would then gain access back to her. There is another relationship with a Wayne Wood. I want to know if she has any contact with Wayne, when the last time that was, and what the content of any conversations between them are, whether they're on social media together, text messages, WhatsApp, or anything like that. Obviously, people fantasise about killing their ex-husbands. Jokes are made about it, but sometimes it goes beyond that. We need to look at the background of the person and who they are, ex-partners, ex-husbands, how the divorce came about, whether there's children involved. But it's whether you take a fantasy and move it into some sort of plan of action to try and carry out some harm to that ex-partner.
What's that one?
Oh, there. Oh, okay, awesome. Yeah, okay. Suspect alleged to have sent text messages of abusive and harassing nature. Also, is alleged to have set fire to a motor vehicle owned by Rob Parks, who is also the victim of the harassment.
Oh, my good God. That's nuts.
Intelligence received from Thames Valley Police reveals that Victoria Breeden was arrested 5 years previously in connection with an arson attack.
She's a genuine danger to this bloke.
In the new year of 2014, I heard my car alarm go off at 4:30 in the morning, and my car was on fire.
Barney?
Yeah.
The car on the driveway went up and it blew out all the windows in the house.
Oh, my.
With the family inside.
The windows blew in. The explosion completely destroyed my daughter's room, where she had been sleeping seconds before that. The front door was melted. We managed to get out.
And then the text message just started.
Fucking pedo, shit dealer scum, you shit cunt, Robin Parks. We're going to burn down your house.
And again, it's that paedophile theme running through it, isn't it? That's quite horrendous, some of those messages.
Wayne Wood was convicted. I had known Wayne for a few months before that. He couldn't possibly have wanted to do that to us by himself.
And I'm just trying to locate someone who I believe may have been released from prison recently. He got sentenced to 7 years for an arson. It's Wayne Wood. This is Victoria's second husband. Wayne Wood was a soldier in the Royal Engineers based in Germany at some point, OK? It seems at some point around 2014, Wayne Wood and Victoria have been arrested for arson with intent to endanger life and harassment on Rob Parks. Wayne Wood subsequently stood trial for that and sentenced to 7 years. He's now out of prison after serving somewhere just over 4 years. So he's out on licence and he's in the Bedford area. Looks like Victoria Breeden was NFA'd.
She wasn't ever charged with anything because she wasn't placed at the scene. She was not connected to that in any other way other than through her husband at the time. I feel sorry for Wayne. I understand how
he didn't have a way to deal with the level of control that she had on him. But what he did was put my family's life in danger.
She told me that her ex-husband used to mentally abuse her, that he was molesting the children, and that kind of made me see red a little bit. She had told me the address, where they lived, and you won't get caught, and it's a good idea. She knew how to twist it and push it onto me. And it just kept going on and on about it until it had gone out. Next thing I know, car gone off.
I want that clarified in interview, and I want a challenge on that. I genuinely believe she will continue or will carry it out at some point, the way she's fixated with him, I think. It's not good, is it? It's not good at all.
It's a very serious offence, and it's the turning point in the investigation for me. I think it shows how dangerous a woman we're dealing with. If somebody has got away with a very serious crime and hasn't been brought to justice for it, especially if it's a very serious offence, and you manage to manipulate someone to commit that offence on your behalf, I think that can make you feel that you can do it again quite easily.
Hello, mate, you all right?
With police needing to re-interview Victoria Breeden, she begins complaining she is suffering severe back pain.
Right. Mm-hmm. So now she's saying that she's got a poor back, that she goes up hospital to be assessed and checked out, so obviously that'll cause delay. So, there we are.
It's just another twist.
So Victoria's health is always, you know, a common topic. She studied health sciences and her mum's a nurse, so, you know, there's always been a medical knowledge. She had a constant need for medical intervention from when I first knew her all the way through. She would say how ill she was and how much pain she was in. There were monthly visits into different hospitals. Nothing was ever distinctly diagnosed. It provided her a way to control the environment, to control the situation, and to control me. It's something that she perfected with me, but she has used through the years.
I think she wants attention all the time. She loves confrontation. She loves it. All this, if she's being ill, she's pretending it. I guarantee you. What she does is, if she's not getting her own way, she makes such a song and a dance that they have to believe what she says. She's in control, isn't she? Look at her there. She's climbing up and down chairs in this living room, stretching and pulling and moving and lifting things. She pretends because it gets attention. Victoria's a con woman. I think she has been like this for a long time.
How long are we looking at for the lady up there, mate? Waiting times, etc.
Does need a scan, that'll take up to 24
hours. The way she behaves is not something I've ever seen. It makes me feel very, very worried. Because I don't think she's going to stop till she carries out what she wants to do.
Yeah.
Do I still worry she might get away with it? Yes, I do.
this feedback. Yep,
she told us that she'd had an operation on her back. Everyone that we speak to say she hasn't got any issues whatsoever. She's won.
In all my career, I've never experienced anything like this.
Someone has tried taking advantage of me and getting me to do things that I wouldn't want to do anyway.
It's not normal to have £23,500 stashed in your house.
You're quite a dangerous woman, aren't you, Miss Preedon? Dangerous enough that you try repeatedly to ask men to harm Rob.
She says, if I can get you a gun, would you do it for us?
That's at the same time tomorrow. And support information for anyone affected by any of the issues in the programme can be found at channel4.com/support. Well, next tonight, they risked everything to come to the UK. One survived, one didn't. A 5-year investigation into the truth behind the man who fell from the sky in just a moment.
How easy is it to get in contact with somebody that can make someone disappear?
Why, who do you want to disappear?
It's my ex-husband.
How did you meet her?
My dating site. I think in the early days she did genuinely care for me. But I think she had an ulterior motive now.
A bloke by the name of Graham Wall is in a relationship with a girl by the name of Victoria Breeden.
Right there, wrong way, I left my phone in her living room, under the stairs, with a voicemail recording.
I know where he lives.
Right, OK.
Can you think?
What?
Yeah, well, I'm not
going to
write it down, am I?
She walked into Ely Police Station.
At this moment in time, I'm placing you under arrest. I'm placing you under arrest for the offence of conspiracy to commit murder.
And next thing you know, she's literally on the floor, wouldn't get up.
This is Earl Gurnon. He's the male in the recording who she's asking to disappear her first husband.
She's some random bird who stalks me off the internet.
It was a joke, it wasn't serious. I didn't want him to go and do anything.
I think she is capable of getting somebody to do it.
I heard my car alarm go off at 4:30 in the morning, and my car was on fire.
They then traced that to Victoria's husband at the time, Wayne.
Wayne Wood subsequently stood trial for that and sentenced to 7 years. So now she's saying that she's got a poor back, that she goes up hospital. She was up at hospital for quite a while and the hospital were happy to release her.
They've checked her over, they say there's not a lot wrong with her.
She's here.
Christ! Get on the floor!
This is your opportunity to talk to me.
They have lifted prints. Are they going to be yours?
Every minute that's ticking away is evidence you're losing.
You cold?
No, I just feel sick.
Okay. How are you?
And let us know if you're going to be sick. Pop in, see if we've got a vomit bowl in the medic room. Yeah, we'll sort that out in a second.
That's interesting. That's interesting. Very interesting. So we think she might have Munchausen's. So whether that's particularly true or not is another matter, isn't it? Nice one. Cheers for your help. Right, she might have Munchausen's. It's where you pretend to have all sorts of illnesses, isn't it? You feign illness and injury for attention, but I don't think she's ever actually been diagnosed with that.
Is there anything else going on that I need to be aware of?
Just pain.
Pain where?
Yeah, so you've been...
My back.
Is that new pain?
I knew that was in the cars. Yeah.
New...
They're going to be ready at...
Yes, I'm
right. Those officers will be ready at 11.
Okay.
It's a condition, but looks
lovely when it runs. Right. Okay.
If you would like to perambulate, C15 is that way. Yeah.
Under arrest for conspiracy to murder, Earl Gernon is allowed a phone call. He chooses to speak to his mother.
Conspiracy to murder? It took me half a day since about 2 o'clock this afternoon to find out what the word conspiracy actually meant. It means talk about or plan. No, it's not just an allegation. There's actually been audio of it. It's some other bird that I met on the internet being weird. Because it seems like everybody tries to manipulate me and tell me what to do in my life, don't they? Because everybody knows I'm a little bit thick. Someone has tried taking advantage of me and get me to do things that I wouldn't want to do anyway. And I think I'm in a shitload of trouble, mate, for doing nothing. Absolutely fucking nothing. All right, mum, bye.
He's been very stressed and very traumatised and upset. Makes me feel very, very sad indeed, because a lot of women, a lot of people take my son the wrong way. They think that he's rude, he's arrogant, etc., etc. He's not. He suffers with ADHD and mild anger issues. My son has always wanted people to like him, because ADHD is a very lonely place to be. It is. He will pacify people. And that's what he did that night that he went to that lady's address. I know that he's not capable of ever murdering anybody in his life. My son has been used. I'm very angry with this woman. If I was to meet her in person, I feel that I'd strike her. But I know I must not do that. Women that are in love are capable of being very, very dangerous.
Police had no choice but to allow Victoria Breeden to go to hospital after she complained of severe back pain. Now being deemed fit for interview, detectives want to question her about the arson attack made on her first husband, Rob Parks.
Are those the photographs from the file that we got yesterday?
Yeah, from Thames Valley.
That's horrendous, mate, isn't it?
Yeah. Car's absolutely destroyed.
The investigation back then attributed it to Wayne Wood.
Did miss about there, did they?
Wayne set fire to the car on the driveway, but he wished he'd never married her.
I think the clever people get other people to commit crimes for them.
What's your full name, please, Wayne?
Wayne Adam
Wood. How old are you?
She goes for men, but she goes for certain types of men.
I want you to tell me everything that's happened between you and Vicky Regan.
Yeah, sure.
The men have to be vulnerable so they believe what she's telling them. I think she's looking for someone that she thinks would say yes. She's very careful in her selection.
when you're with someone, you pay attention, but you don't really pay attention. Didn't really see the warning signs.
Right, Victoria.
We spoke to Rob, and he gave us a statement about some of the background, and he says that in 2014, I know it's been tried, that the car blew up on his driveway and blew the windows out in his house with him inside it, OK? And that's what Wayne did, and that's what you were arrested for.
She told me that her ex-husband, that he was molesting the children, and that kind of made me see red a little bit.
There is no way I knew what was going on. If I had, I would have stopped it.
She was twisting my mental health against me. She'd said that I was abusive, physically, mentally. I'd taken all her money off her. I've done nothing for that. Looking back onto it, I'm glad I'm not with her no more. And I feel sorry for anybody that's got involved for it or will do in the future.
I think she thinks she's smarter than everyone, because she has been. What she does works.
Okay.
It looks like she's approaching vulnerable men, men with problem mental health issues, who may have a violent criminal history as well.
Well, she's not choosing random men, is she?
She isn't choosing random men.
She's choosing ones that are useful to her.
Exactly. We know that Wayne Wood had PTSD or some form of mental health. Graham, with the best will in the world, probably has some.
A bit vulnerable.
And then yeah. Earl Gurnon probably has some mental health issues.
I pretty much openly tell him that I've got learning difficulties and things like that, and I'm autistic. She seemed very intelligent to me. She used to work for the NHS, she's got degrees.
You know, I wanted to go out and get another girl, basically, so I thought I'd went online dating. It didn't quite work that way, did it?
She's quite a tricky customer. She'll be in a wheelchair. She talks quite quietly, quite slowly.
It's always at the same victim, yeah. It's all basically aimed at Rob Parks, who's her first husband, who she's got a child with, who she wants back. I mean, she's going to go down the line, I think, that she didn't mean it. The recording's just a silly, drunken conversation. And then, obviously, we could report that.
With their current inquiries concluded, police are ready to charge Victoria Breeden.
So we've got good evidence in that sense.
But she is refusing to leave her cell.
All right, Victoria, we've been to CPS with the evidence we've got, and then they've come back with authorising to charge you with a criminal offence, OK? Which I've now got to read out to you. On the 2nd of the 10th, 2019, at Ely in the county of Cambridgeshire, conspired together with Earl Gurnon to murder Rob Parks. Are you all right under there?
Both suspects are charged. Earl Gurnon is released on bail. Victoria Breeden is remanded to prison.
There's no definite that she'll be found guilty at court, and there's always a possibility a jury will find her not guilty.
The police can't use the arson attack as evidence in court. So to strengthen their case, they speak to Victoria Breeden's previous partners. If they reveal anything incriminating, they will need to question her again to get her side of the story.
Russell, we need to try and track him down. He looks, from what we know of the issues around 2014, that he might be within Bedfordshire and Bedfordshire may have spoken to him. Do we get any intelligence back from them around him?
So the most recent address they've got is the one he shared with Victoria.
Might be worth a door knock there. I wonder what he's got to tell us.
It's my
my name's Louisa. I'm a police officer for Cambridgeshire Police. Hi there. I'm with Detective Sergeant Barnshaw, and we're just in Bedford now.
Russell, so how long were you actually with Victoria?
Not even a year. Met her in a pub in Luton.
The reason I'm here, mate, is Victoria's been arrested for conspiracy to commit a murder. The CPS agreed to charge her. She's remanded at the moment in prison.
She is in prison,
yeah. She tried to get out, but we put an application in to say no, and she didn't. The judge said, no, you're not leaving. She's trying to get somebody to hurt Rob, basically get Rob to disappear. Yeah. Did she ever ask you to do anything to him, or even suggest
it? Not that I remember.
In your presence at all?
No.
Okay, that's fine.
We do know that she attempted to get, when she was fully involved with Wayne and he was still at the Ministry of Defence, we know that they approached colleagues in Germany to take Rob out.
I think you tried to fill the gaps to support that this is a course of conduct. It's not just a one-off.
She seems to have quite a number of boyfriends and men throughout her life.
One she can use, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what she does. If she won't get her own hands dirty, she'll always try and get other people's he's not got.
As soon as you find out about Waynewood and that arson, and then Graham, there's too big a time gap for her not to have asked someone else. So there's got to be people in the middle that just haven't said anything. We've had some intelligence that was on Bed's police system, which said that Victoria was approaching soldiers whilst in Germany. The one that she's named or she's approached is an Andrew Peebles and is happy to give us a statement.
The first time I met them, I seen a British car broken down on the side of the road, so I thought, I'll stop and help them. So I stopped. Basically, they were telling us about her ex, saying that he was a paedophile, all that sort of stuff. Saying stuff about how she wants her kid back and everything like that. And then they says to me, she says, if I can get you a gun, would you do it for us? And I was just like, these have got to be having a laugh.
Okay. And what's Wayne doing when all this is going on?
He's just sitting in the car.
He's just listening to it?
Just listening to it, yeah. He's basically saying that he'd do anything for her.
When I think she did ask about how easy it is to get weapons from the army.
Right. Andrew Peebles is a name that's figured in this inquiry. Yeah, was he a friend of yours in the army?
No. He was part of the same camp.
Yeah.
But he was in a different regiment.
Okay.
And he saw the English registration broken down on the autobahn.
Right.
And he just stopped.
Okay.
To help out.
Okay.
Can I mention anything about Hamish?
Yeah.
One day, you had a phone call from him saying, do you want a pair of us to go around to have coffee with him and just have a chat? And he said, he was chatting away, he says, Victoria had come up to him and says, do you know anybody who can do something to, what was it?
Rob.
Yeah.
Where's Hamish?
He's used to live on the ring. Whether he's still there now, I don't know. What his surname is, I haven't a clue.
Hi, Hamish. You all right? Have you got 1 second to talk?
I think it was outside the boat, sit on the side, and she basically said it was along the lines of, do you know people back in Scotland? They're still not. I was like, yeah. I said, I don't know. Like, really, really strange people. And she eventually and she said, oh, my ex-husband stopped me from seeing the kids. He's made up stories about me. I can get a bit of money if you know somebody who can sort them out. And I just thought, like, that's not.
What did you think she meant sorting out?
There was definitely an intent to say to do harm to him.
Did she say how much money it
five,
was?
£5,000.
What you've just said is quite significant to us, so I really appreciate your time and help, Hamish, mate.
But
we'll leave you be.
Spot. That is worth the trip for me.
Brilliant.
It's stacking up quite nicely, really, isn't it? On the basis of all that, we're going to produce up. We'll get that jacked up.
Yeah, we're going to have to. Yeah. I think she wants him dead.
I think she might well do.
Sorry for the short notice, but we're going to produce Victoria Breeden from Peterborough Prison to Thorpe Wood to interview her today about some fresh offences.
You need to pull yourself forward and you need to use your own strength because we're in a prone position, so it's going to hurt our backs. So use the handle there because that handle will stay solid. There we go, right, chairs away.
So I'm just making you aware that she'll probably need some representation at Fort Wood at some point today. It's going to be some counts of solicitation to Murdoch.
Cheers, bye.
He's
going to
go so low for the
speed bump. Yep, that's my hit. Right, we better hit the road, mate,
haven't
we?
Yep. Fingers crossed. The records that we got from Thames Valley, she was bailed 8 times because she kept getting medical note, self-admitted to hospital, all sorts of stuff. And in one of their statements, they describe her as a Walter Mitty character.
That's an old-fashioned saying, yeah. But yeah.
It's
yeah.
A character and a character and yeah. A character and a character. Yeah. And who is she actually?
Yeah.
And that is, I think that's what she's thinking, sat in that cell.
I think you're right. I think she just generally think it'll all just disappear and yeah. Go away and she won't be able to count for anything.
Yeah, because people either believe her act or can't disprove it. Even a doctor can't.
No, they can't. Because they've got her head on the side of caution just in case, haven't they?
So that is so difficult for this investigation. She knows exactly what she's doing. We just need to play the game better.
Yeah.
She had an injection in her back and she played on it for 5 weeks. Took her to the clinic at Cambridge and, you know, then we stop outside the outpatients and she struggles to get out of the car. And a couple of times she's had a wheelchair to get in there, you know. Oh, I just think, what a cop.
I know you said about your asthma, but they've said to us, they've given us a handover, that everything should be very straightforward.
Yes,
ma'am. And medically, there's no reason why you can't come here and there's nothing that should cause any issues, OK? Otherwise, we simply wouldn't do it.
Swing your bum around for us.
We went to a hotel in Keighley. She was fuming, there was no lift. And she got the big old pushchair that we had. And went to carry it up the stairs with a suitcase. And I said, hang on a minute. I said, leave them at the bottom, I'll bring them up. I said, otherwise you'll be complaining your back hurts. No, I can manage. And she trotted upstairs with them. I think it's just that she makes such a song and a dance that they have to believe what she says.
Hello there. Hello. Defence, please.
It's alleged that Miss Breeden has looked to seek services of other people to commit murder.
Okay, from what my colleagues explained to me, I'm going to authorise your detention so that you can be questioned. Okay? You understand? You don't understand. What don't you understand? You've been arrested on suspicion of solicitation to commit murder. Do you understand what that means? I'm authorising you to remain here so the officers can speak to you on interview.
Okay. I have my inhaler now, please.
Your inhaler? Okay. You're breathing fine at the moment.
My chest's tight.
Okay, we can sort something out, I'm sure. Okay, what's your name, please?
She's sat in the wheelchair in the custody, saying she doesn't know why she's here, she doesn't know anything about anything, she doesn't understand what's going on. She needs an appropriate adult. What's next? She'll have polio by the end of the week or something, won't she?
Any foods you can't eat?
Just anything with gluten.
So, gluten-free, which limits our selection quite a lot.
Victoria Breeden is assigned an appropriate adult to safeguard her during the police interview.
I wouldn't cope with a normal NHS chair.
You look different in your chair too.
Yeah. At least I don't look like Myra Hindley anymore. I don't look like a serial killer.
So she can have pilau rice.
She said she wants a sandwich.
No, she's not having a sandwich. If she's gluten-free, she will have gluten-free food.
Yeah.
She's
sold. Then she'll say she's ill.
but she makes all sorts of allegations. So. She's not having this. She can have a gluten-free meal or nothing. It's her choice.
This is the gluten-free meal that I'm offered. It's got beef in it. You don't eat meat? All right, are you veggie? All right, right.
So that's it.
Okay, well, I've truly offered everything we have. If you are a celiac, it's too much of a risk to have the fillings contaminated by gluten. Can you have anything spicy? No? Right, okay. Well, give me a minute. Thank you.
I don't know if this is gluten-free either, but I really don't care. Just don't say anything.
Yeah, I think when some people come into custody, they want to keep that element of control as much as they can. I can imagine that someone might enjoy disrupting the process. So, we're going to go get us some food.
Okay.
Okay. I'll keep my bite my tongue. Yeah, we've sent an officer now, so I'll let you know. I think anyone could look at those small actions and think they don't add up to much, when in reality she just sees it as getting what she wants, a game or a battle to her, that's her life.
I was instructed vegan and gluten-free, so I did my best.
You did, yeah, spot on.
I'm quite impressed with my...
Has this got a spoon in it or anything?
No.
Well, while she's waiting for it to get done, she might as well sit in there and eat the food.
Chase the sweet corn round.
I have some gluten-free vegan food.
Thank you.
Brilliant.
Well, that's
better
than nothing, right?
We've got some wraps as well, so... Victoria definitely fights back. In any way she knows how.
Solicitor is here. It's just whether we'll get her into an interview before
4 o'clock this afternoon.
Yeah.
Well, let's just sit in there for a minute.
Thank you.
Right.
You know what I mean for everything.
It's okay.
I can't wait to be home.
It's horrible.
You have absolutely no idea. He doesn't deserve a mum in prison. I'd rather be dead.
Don't say that. Never say that. Okay. Do you want to do a consultation and I'll get this case going?
Right, I've got to sort that out.
In advance of Victoria Breeden's interview, officers disclose their new evidence to her solicitor.
You give disclosure, they have consultation, you go into interview. There's not really any delays in between that process. Be all right to go down to that room to have a consultation? I don't see why not. So we're going to go down there.
See you in a minute.
Right.
Victoria Breeden now knows the strength of the evidence in the case against her.
And that went okay. And she asked if we got statements from everyone and who they are, and I've just said we've got statements from a number of them, and he asked what the statements were. I said I'd cover that in interview, obviously. But it's probably along the same lines of her trying to arrange to hurt Rob Parks. Left it at that.
But before the detectives can put their evidence to her, she asked to see a healthcare practitioner.
If it's too painful to keep going.
You'd have to speak to your solicitor. You know your pain, really. So, the problem that we have is the medication, they haven't sent it boxed and labelled. Hello? So, what I can do, you require that specific? Are you feeling sick at the minute? I can only give you paracetamol. That's all I've got. I've got nothing stronger.
I'm in no fit state to do anything without pain relief.
Would you rather this is set up for tomorrow, another day, when they bring you pain relief and everything?
Can we do that?
Let me see if it's a possibility.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, here we go.
Oh,
they're ready. Let's do it.
What time do you normally have your pain relief at prison?
12 o'clock. That's why I was asking for it.
So it's not as and when, you take it regularly?
The issue is that she's in a lot of pain.
She's in a lot of pain?
Yeah. And she would therefore have difficulties in going ahead and into you. So the medic said she can have a Methadone.
Yeah.
But really she should have the correct medication to do her interview. So would it be possible to rearrange this?
All the HCP can offer is paracetamol.
That's the things I've got.
I'll speak to the prison. I'll try and be as quick as I can and let you know then.
Not the easiest thing would be for somebody to go and get it. Bearing in mind the prison's 10 minutes away.
I don't think they're allowed to. It's a controlled drug, so two people have to sign it off.
I might just lose my shit big time in a minute. And I'm not joking.
What's happening now?
Right, the next stage of this saga is she's saying that she needs her pain relief for her back pain. The prison have not given her that medication when she was produced, okay? I'm gonna ring the prison now and find out when she should have her pain relief. She's been offered medical care and we've even gone out and bought her the food that she needs.
Yeah.
I think we should carry on.
We need to do the same interview that we always planned on doing. And this is, like, key stuff. We can't have this interview chucked out.
I've never, in all my career, I've never experienced anything like this.
Someone might want to delay interview following consultation because if they think we've got evidence, it allows them time to think about what they're going to say in interview. She bides herself time to think. In my 6 years, I can't think of a case where someone's managed to delay after disclosure. I think Victoria is the most clever criminal I've come across, not necessarily in terms of the offence that she's committing, but how she plays the system.
Hello, we've produced a Victoria Breeden from your establishment this morning and brought her here to Thortwood. She is quite a difficult individual. She's presenting with all sorts of medical issues and now she's saying she's come without the relevant medication and her solicitor's now saying she doesn't believe, without taking that, she's not well enough to be interviewed. Because she's here now, we're ready to interview her at 3 o'clock, 3:30 and get her back, so she wouldn't be suffering anything medically and excruciating pain by us keeping it here and interviewing her if she doesn't take that medication. Right, that answers my question. That's brilliant. Thanks a lot, mate. Appreciate that. Cheers. Bye. They're saying she's only been on it a short length of time and she would not be in excruciating pain or not able to know what's going on. They wouldn't be concerned about not giving it to her at all and she can have it when she gets back to the prison. It's just ludicrous. It puts us in a ludicrous position.
If you are genuinely in a lot of pain, it would have an effect. It would.
Yeah, but we can.
But this is a completely different situation. She would have known what time she's going to say about needing food. She knows this the whole way along, to give her time to think.
We're in the hands of the HCP now. If she says yes, we're moving. If she says no, she'll have to go back.
I know this sounds really, really stupid, but bear with me. Does it help if you put your weight onto your other side?
Oh, no. Such a win.
Despite guidance from the prison that another dose of painkillers is not necessary, the healthcare practitioner decides Victoria Breeden is not fit for interview without further pain relief.
I think we might have to admit defeat.
Cheers, mate. Bye.
HCP is saying she's asked her numerous times, even if she takes the drugs, can she still stop the interview if she says she's in pain?
She's won.
She's won, yeah.
Full on ginger rage. Now I need to think logically.
The police officer just told me that you will be going back to prison very soon, all right? So you're not going to be interviewed, okay?
My colleagues are continuing with their inquiries. Take it you want to take your apps with you?
Tara manipulates. She manipulates the situation. If she can get something for nothing, she'll do it. If she can con somebody out of something, she'll do it. 5 weeks into the relationship, she said, well, I think we need to start talking about making wills. And I said, well, we've only been together 5 weeks. The alarm bell started to ring in my head. But you see, Victoria is very passionate about money. She's obsessed with money. And I remember after that discussion over the will, she'd asked me to hang these curtains and they were in the wardrobe, so I looked in the wardrobe and I couldn't find them, so then I looked in the wardrobe drawer. And as I opened the drawer, I couldn't believe my eyes. I messaged her and I said, I found your stash.
Hello, Graeme, it's Mike Barnshaw, DS from Man Parkside in Cambridge.
You mentioned some messages. Would you forward them on in whatever form you can, mate? I'd really like to see these messages. I've got a message from Graham. He's shown me a picture of some money that he says was at Victoria's house.
Any good?
That's interesting.
Shit. That's a lot of money. Where is that in her house?
So the top drawer of the wardrobe,
yep.
I opened that, and as I opened it, it jammed slightly on the shelf above it,
yep.
And one of these lids had got caught, and the lid pulled off as I pulled the drawer open. Anyway, I put it all back, and I messaged her, and I said, we need to talk. We got on about this money. I said, come on, I said, it's not normal to have £23,500, because that's how much was there originally, stashed in your house. I have no idea where it's come from. I've got no involvement with that. She was putting some into a bank account and she was using it for spending. She loves money, doesn't she? Well, we all like it.
There are now 4 additional counts of solicitation to murder which need to be put to Victoria Breeden. They bring her back into custody for questioning.
Okay. Yeah. Have you got any injuries? What are those?
My back and my leg.
And what is the injury to your back?
Slipped disc.
Okay, so you've got a slipped disc. And your leg?
So one is kicking off your chain.
Is that the only injuries?
Chronologically then, we're going to go...
Wayne. Peebles.
She says, if I can get you a gun, would you do it for us?
I love Hamish's statement. It's absolutely damning.
I can get a bit of money if you know somebody who'd sort them out. There is definitely an intent to seriously do harm to them.
Whoa.
Graham Wall.
She said, you must know somebody. You must know somebody who can get rid of him. And then she said to me,
if you can't do that, you're no use to me.
The medic is quite happy, as you stand right now, that you're fit to be interviewed, OK, and fit to be with us. And we'll sort through this as we go along. All right?
All right, let's go. Are you all right leaving, yeah?
Yeah.
Right, here we go. The lid's on properly, we've tested it.
Is the air out?
Some of the air's out, yeah.
Do we have a Bible? She asked for a Bible.
A Bible?
Yeah.
What can you tell me about a man called Andrew Peebles?
I don't remember anybody called that.
No one at all. So, he describes, one Friday afternoon, I was driving along in Germany, and noticed a Nissan broken down at the side of the road. I then assisted in towing the vehicle back to base. Andrew said you spoke about your ex. At any point during the conversation with Andrew, did you inquire as to whether he could kill your ex-husband?
I don't know who that is.
He says you did.
I haven't asked anybody to do anything.
He says you asked him to kill him.
I don't know who you're talking about, I'm sorry.
It gets a bit more specific. Did you say to him that you would get him a gun and give him whatever money he wanted in order to kill your ex.
You never said that to anybody.
Now we're talking about guns and money. How much money did you offer?
I don't know who it is, and I haven't had that conversation.
Because we've spoken to Wayne, and he remembers Andrew Peebles. He remembers him.
Then he's a friend of Wayne's. I've not met him.
You're quite a dangerous woman, aren't you, Miss Breeden? Dangerous enough that you try repeatedly to ask men to harm Rob.
I never wanted him harmed. I've never had conversations about that, no.
That recording was just the icing on the cake, wasn't it? Because we just caught you that time. But you have been doing this for years.
Okay, everyone, thanks for coming. This is a briefing in relation to Operation Boona. We've had information through Graham Wall that there was a large amount of cash in the address around about the time that he was in a relationship with her, and that's a picture he's given to us, which is he believes there was somewhere in the region of £18,000 in cash in this SMA tin. We do not know what's happened to that money, and obviously that money there, it's good evidence that she had access to the funds to commit the offence for which she was talking to Earl about. So Louise Arthur obtained a search warrant to enter Victoria's premises and to conduct a search in relation to finding that cash.
Please, anyone in here make yourself known? Shout up.
Where did you live when Wayne left the army?
It was near the embankment.
Does the name Hamish mean anything to you?
No, sorry.
In an interview she said she didn't know him, but in her phone book dated handily September 2015, there's Hamish's number. I'll just read through a conversation, hopefully that would jog your memory. So Hamish said, for a couple of weeks, everything was okay and Wayne and Vicky seemed really nice. On one occasion, she came round to the boat one night. I was stood in the kitchen making coffee and she made a comment that I'd been so helpful and I was such a nice person. He said, you then said, wouldn't do me a favour, would you? Will you sort out my ex-husband? He's a bastard. Do you know people back in Scotland who are still nutters?
That doesn't sound like anything I would ever say.
At which point you've said, I can get a bit of money if you know someone who can sort him out.
I haven't had that conversation.
We're mentioning money again. Hamish said you offered him £5,000.
£5,000.
I'm
sorry, I don't remember.
Do you have £5,000?
No.
Where was it?
So in that was there? In the... So it was in this bag.
It looks like paper, it looks like money. So...
Okay, go for it.
That is literally bursting at the seams, isn't it?
I would just leave that.
Yep. Yeah, seal it and we will seize it. Well done. And I've got no further questions. So, interview stopped at 18:06.
Total of £18,690.
With all their inquiries complete, the police asked the CPS to approve charges on all counts.
Thank you very much for your decision. Cheers. Bye.
I'm pleased for Rob and for Wayne and for Graham that we managed to get her. She'd made all of these people feel like what was reality wasn't happening. She'd made them feel like they were imagining it. She'd twisted and turned the system so much in her favour that all of these punishments that should have come before this didn't happen. And it was our job, because we were lucky to have the evidence at that point, to make sure that we got the charge on that occasion. And if we hadn't have done, I think she'd have continued to make Rob's life in particular quite difficult.
I want to show to my daughter that not everybody is going to be like Victoria. But you should trust people. I feel sad that my daughter's mother has given that to her. It's not something that I would want to put on anybody. And all these other guys, I feel for them. I really do, because I've been there. And I know what they've been through. I know what it's like. Too many people got hurt. A lot of people that Victoria has influenced have not been as lucky as me.
I go to places that I quite often when I have anxiety and things like that. Just need to get away from society and think, innit?
I don't think I'll go online dating again, to be fair. No, too many catfishes.
It wasn't all bad.
You still love her?
Yeah. Yes, I do. I don't like her very much. Because it's genuine love, you see. It's not just make-believe.
More of you.
And support information can be found online at channel4.com/support. Now, we are rushed back into St George's for our brand new series. A patient is airlifted after being knocked unconscious and a man has fallen downstairs in 24 hours in A&E here next Tuesday at 9. Back to tonight, getting intimate with strangers in Swingers.